Hello, everybody, and welcome to Heart with Sandhya. Today and this week, in fact, we've been talking about simplifying our lives, not just decluttering our closets, but the metaphorical ones as well. And I have with me a very special guest today. She is a dear friend, a fierce friend, and a former colleague as well, and a former banker. This is Shweta Bhave. Shweta, thank you so much for joining us today on Heart to Heart.
Hi, Sandhya.
Hi, how are you doing?
Oh, as well as you.
That's not too bad, I have to say. Yeah, first of all, Shweta, thank you for doing this. I know you were a little reluctant to come on camera to talk about your life like this, but the reason why this is so important for me is that I think for a lot of us, we begin our lives with a lot of clutter, with a lot of noise, with a lot of chaos. And it's been a work in progress just to sort of simplify and, you know, get rid of stuff, get rid of toxic relationships. But with you, I've always felt, whether we were working together or even as friends and, you know, having visited your home and been so many parts of your life, that there's always a sense of space in everything that you do. You know, your desk was always neater than mine. Your desktop was always neater than mine. Your closet's always neater than mine. And I know because I've helped myself to many things in yours. So I wanted to start by asking you that, how do you create this sense of space? Is it a struggle for you like it is for so many of us?
No, I don't think so. I used to be like that too earlier. I was always actually a compulsive declutterer. It always, so even when I go to shops, when the guy is showing me something, and if I'm done away with it, then I tend to fold it and keep it away and all, because I need that clarity and space whatever I'm doing. So yeah, a part of it has been there, and a lot of it has been an evolution maybe over the last few years.
I have noticed, for example, that you know, your desire to take on new things is far less. And I mean, the irony is that you work in retail, right? And have worked for nearly 10 years in retail now. What is it that, you know, we all see beautiful things and you have a beautiful home, but there's so much space in it. You know, there are few things, but each of them is beautiful. Something as simple as, what is your ability to say no when you do have the access and when you do have the resources, you know?
So I like my closet, my house, my bath. Oh, sorry.
That's okay. It's so
I like Zen spaces, especially in my house, because I like to come home to a house which gives me this very calming vibes. On top of it, especially at work, I'm surrounded by so many things that it's very important to have that cutoff when you come home. So, and maybe, you know, I get my thrill by just doing up the space at work and going crazy, because I've had lovely people who I work with and they give me that that free hand to let it be as I like it.
But for those of us that aren't, I mean, say we're coming back from the office and coming home, just the ability to sort of say no to things. Like, for example, when we both have gone shopping together or even just gone to a restaurant, I see that you say no to so much more. And you know, you're sort of, is it that your standards are very high, or what is the rule that you use before you bring something into your life? We'll start with the physical
front. Yeah, you can say I'm very, very picky. I've burned my fingers. I've bought a lot of rubbish in my younger years, not especially in the last few years. And just, you know, the kind of things we hoard and then you have to give away. And I'm very happy to give away my things. But then some of the things that we buy, we don't really have people to hand it over to.
Yeah.
So then so much of consumerism, so much of waste that happens. It's been a slow wake-up call, I would say. And so I'm very particular. I don't keep too much storage in the house. There won't, if there is storage, you tend to pack things in. Like I was telling you some days back also, you know, like my wardrobe is restricted to just one cupboard. It's not a very big one. Yeah. So if I don't have five wardrobes, I'll not fill it up with so many things. And visually, I like my spaces to be clean. So I know I'm also not going to leave packets and boxes lying all around my bedroom.
Mm-hmm. That's a really valuable point. You know, we tend to sort of want to create bigger and bigger storage. And, you know, it's like If you open it, it will come. It's like a garage, right? You leave it open, the car will come.
What is ironical is that when people have a lot of stuff, they can't find it. So they, I mean, I have friends whose wardrobes are like, literally, if you open it, things will come falling off. But they'll wear the same 5 pair of clothes because you can't sight the other 110 which are lying buried under the bags and cosmetics and what have you.
So true, so true. I used to be one of those as well. But like I said,
you have been decluttering a lot, and I have received a lot of goodies while you have been decluttering.
So then that brings me to my next question. What is the sort of rule you use? Now, the net total of things that you own somehow seems to remain constant. So when something comes in, what is the rule? We're not Marie Kondo, but I know you've always had rules for what you use to get rid of things. What is it that you use?
So one of my friends, her husband, like when this awareness was not there in me, he used to say, you know, that if I buy two things, I remove two things from my wardrobe. Like if I buy two shirts, then I'll make sure that I give two shirts away from what I have. So I tend to follow that too. Especially in the last few months that we've been sitting at home, there has been an urge, you know, to add this and add that and all, because you have time to sit and go through your various websites and all, which you didn't have before. But then I become very aware of what I'm doing, and I know I'm just going to add to what I have. Like, I, for example, I was out of night suits, and I really, like, I had zeroized in what I wanted to buy. And then I have these separate clothes that I carry when I travel. So instead of buying, I remember that, oh, why can't I just wear those pajama suits now? Because I'm not going to be traveling for the next few months anywhere.
Some of it
has something to do with my birth sign. I think I'm a Virgo. We are like compulsive cleanliness freaks.
So I'm gonna call that confirmation bias. But in this case, I feel like if a confirmation bias helps you to be the kind of person you want to be, go ahead and label yourself. You know that. I love that rule. You know, when two things come in, two things have to go out. That's a useful rule. Now, I'm going to ask you a very non-Marie Kondo question because we are Indian. And probably she would never even have to grapple with. We have so much of, I mean, you know, I think growing up in the 70s and 80s and 90s, we both are middle class kids from India. I don't know if you saw this in your family, the kind of, like, we used to hoard empty bottles, empty plastic packets. I mean, I still struggle if I finish like a jar of cream. It's so painful for me to give away a perfectly good plastic jar, you know. So these sort of things, and you know, you tend to want to fill your kitchen with things of empty containers, but your kitchen doesn't look like that. So how does one get rid of that mindset, and where do you think that really comes from?
My grandmother was a big time hoarder, my mother less so. So I think over the years, with each generation, it's coming down. I used to keep them too, you know, not plastic. I'm completely anti-plastic. But yes, a lot of glass bottles, especially those pasta sauces and dry fruit and all of them, I used to keep them. And then, you know, like once in a while, when you just see the amount of bottles that have been collected, it's like it puts you off. So now no mercy, you know, no matter how beautiful the bottle of gin is, it goes in trash and so does anything else.
Oh my God.
I just keep what I need.
So it's not, I mean, just because it's beautiful, it's not okay for it to stay.
Absolutely. Because it's clutter. And how much can you use end of the day? You already have pretty things in the house.
Yes.
You live in an apartment. It's a Bombay house. So it's got its limitations. So I'm very happy with those things that I have. And I don't have any urges to keep changing it and change the decor as per season and all of that.
I think sometimes we seek this sort of, yes, earlier there was that scarcity mindset, you know, and especially imported bottles and things like that. But I think now
it's
the novelty. We want to see newness around us. But I think if you see your home as, like you described it, you know, a zen space, it's not the place where you seek excitement, where you seek novelty. Hopefully that will elevate to the levels of our mind. And then perhaps even transcend that, which actually
leads
to to the next level, which is that I see even in your relationships, you're sort of like so minimalist. You don't surround yourself with hundreds of friends. You definitely, even with me, will say no 100 times before you say yes to coming out, which I love that about you, but I'm not sure how everybody else feels. So what is your ability then to, do you not suffer from FOMO? You are on social media, but again, so minimally, and you still make so much time to read and, you know, do the things that you love. How do you handle?
I think you attract like energy, so my friends understand who I am, and it's not like I have few friends. In fact, my husband always tells me that, you know, I marvel at the way you keep adding to your friend circle and all. I have yoga friends, I have work friends, I have school friends, but not everyone is let into my inner sanctum. Even somebody who's very close like you and I, we don't meet up every week, and I'm not even talking about the lockdown world, I'm talking about before that. Again, I feel that familiarity breeds contempt, so hanging out with too many people, hanging out with them for holidays, for movies, for a drink out in the evening, I think somewhere down the line, it just does not always end very well. And I have lost out on a few friends, very few although, in the last few years, because they don't like the way I see things. But I think you have to make peace with that and live with what you love.
Wonderful. You know, you won't believe this, but even like in traditional notions of marriage, there were so many situations where the husband and wife were kept apart. Like the wife would go to the mother's house for certain festivals that the husband wouldn't accompany for. At social gatherings, the men and women are segregated. All of these were done to actually create a sort of separation, like you said, so that we don't become over familiar with the ones, even the ones that we love. But I think modern lifestyle seems to suggest, and modern media seems to suggest, that, you know, you need to be joined at the hip and do everything together and have experience all of life together.
No.
So how very philosophically sound is that? The ones of us that do love you, do respect. I know whenever I ask Shweta for something, I know that there's a good chance, particularly when it involves going out or doing something, the answer is going to be no. And I'm not fine with that. I don't stop trying because I am that kind of person. And Shweta is true to who that she is. Tell me the time that you spend by yourself, Shweta. And I know this is a sort of very personal question. You know, I know you spend a lot of time just in your head with yourself, surrounded just with nothing. What goes on? What does that do for you, and what does that bring you?
Sadhya, the funny thing is that I feel that, like, when I'm at work, I spend more time with myself than I am doing right now, because I sit at the dining table and they think that it's a free for all. My husband, my child, the helper, they all keep coming, and they feel like it's right to strike a conversation. And that's when I realize that I'm so used to being by myself. You know, at work, I don't have too much talking to do. I'm like with my system, my to-dos. I'll call out to my team whenever it's required. And I like it that way. This thing, it gets a bit too much for me nowadays, especially. So it's a bit of a struggle, actually. But if you talk about before, it's just, you know, things that bring me joy. I love to think about how I can improve my space, which is like a big no-no. I'm always accused of spending more time on that than on my actual friends and family. But that's about it, I think. Nothing too deep or philosophical going on there.
And it doesn't need to be, right? I think just us being able to enjoy our own company, it also sort of makes us a lot more intuitive to who we are and what we need. And in turn, better able to manage our relationships, better able to manage the daily stressors. But also, I think, to give us the strength to say no. You know, I think you needed to be that comfortable, because for a lot of us, and I used to be like this as well, I would go out with somebody even that I wasn't particularly, you know, who didn't feel really brought any joy or value to my life, because partly you're scared to be alone, but partly that you're scared to earn the displeasure of the other. And I think they both are interconnected. How do you feel?
Possibly, yes, absolutely. Absolutely, yeah. But I think it's there, what is playing out in your mind. If you crave company and you've never been a I wouldn't call myself introvert, but I have never been the one to be hanging out in large groups and all. I'm very selective about friends and who I call over home or whose places I go to. I have never felt that kind of insecurity, and I'm very happy to be blunt and say, no, I can't do this.
No, that's wonderful. And
when you're younger, I think people tend to get very upset, but now with everyone's maturing, and my friends are like in vary in age circles from 20 to 60, the age groups, but they've somehow been accepting of that. And if somebody says, let's go out for a movie, I'll say no. If somebody says, let's watch a movie at home, I'll be more than happy. I think I'm a very home person. I love being home because I don't get to do too much of it. And even after 4 months, I'm still very happy doing it.
Yeah.
I'm not bored.
I've seen that. Last question. If you had to tell somebody that had a really noisy life, where should one even start? What would be like a tip that we could follow?
Oh my.
Advice column.
I honestly feel that it depends on your physical space. It starts there. You can't be having a very clear mind. Everywhere your eye falls, you know, whether it's your kitchen or your bathroom shelf or your wardrobe, you need to be clean and organized, and then you'll have the mental space to work on your own body and your own mind.
Lovely, yeah. So I think just the physical act of clearing up, right? We'll talk about that. There is some science behind that, but absolutely solid for most of us that are so distracted and unfocused. Great place to start. Thank you for sharing these insights with us, Shweta. I would love, you have such a lovely space both in your home and in your head. So thank you. And I'll keep trying to reach you, and feel free to keep saying no. But may our friendship.
No, Sandhya.
No, you're.
I never say no to you.
No. You do that.
Putting on my dancing shoes and going to a club, then I would definitely say no.
Yeah, I've also gotten smarter with how I contact you. But yeah, like I never give up. But thank you so much. Enjoy the rest of your home, the rest of your day.
I hope it continues that way, yeah.
Well, yes, I mean, your space, but not lockdown for sure. But
yes,
thanks for joining us so much today on Heart to Heart.
Anything for you, Sandhya. Thank you. Bye.